call the meeting to order. February 7th, 2011, Kauffman City Council. We do have a quorum.
I hadn't heard anything from David, and as I said, Claudine is out with.
Need a motion on the agenda?
Who do we set to do this meeting?
Second.
Motion by Lafaurie, second by Robe. Any discussion? All those in favor say yes?
Yes.
Bentley and Miller-Zahradnek are absent. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes of January 17th? Any questions or discussion, anything? If not, I'll stand approved as published and presented. Any motion on the bills pending discussion?
Any motion to pay bills?
Second.
Motion by Robe, second by Herington. Any questions or discussion items announced on page number first?
Juan Blake-Hirschberger, we have to repair on the South 6.
We had our main line that went to the lagoons, right in the parking lot for pornographics, had a leak in it. And that's a charged line the whole time, there's no relief on it, so we had to come in and pump. I didn't know where it was. Not pretty stuff for about 3 hours.
Page two, Chris Schlabaugh.
We had to do, in Alliance request, we put in two safety posts over here for our gas over here. We had one damaged by FedEx driver as well, so they put in a beefier one. He is refunding us the cost of the one that was damaged, and then they bought that pack. So, in essence, we upgraded a pole over there.
On page three, the chicken grit, what quantity is that for 45 seconds?
It's $10 and I can't recall what it was. It's 10-pound bag, so that's about 50 pounds. And we ended up downtown, we used three bags of it. We have two bags in the shop right now, so.
It was well worth it.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's something we want to do on a continuous basis next year. It's crushed granite, and it's hard, obviously. So it did exactly what we needed it to do, but going forward, obviously, we'll have some chemical relief next year with the ice or the salt. One I will bring up is we have one on Berg's Lawn Care on page one. We sheared a pin on our sander. We had to run it up, and it was that day we had all that ice. So we brought Randy in to at least do the areas up by J and the crosswalks that get us in trouble with ice. So we used him for about 3 hours, I believe, is what it ended up being.
And on 9, Thorn Creek closed the water main break on 4.
4th was over, actually just in the alley there, just south of Highway 22, right there at the alley. We had to bring him in because it was right underneath the curb. So he had to dig out behind the curb, and we busted up some concrete so we could get underneath it. Backhoe, we would have ruined the curb, so he brought in a smaller bucket. This is the same.
Questions or discussion items? All those in favor of paying the bill say yes.
Yes.
Others say no. Motion carried. Then, attendance is here from the Sheriff's Department. Motion carried.
Yes, 63 calls served last month, 25 of those medical, and 22 citations. 15 of those were warnings, a lot of snow, little warnings and stuff aside.
I think there was one citation for snow then as well. I don't think anybody knew it was this last snow, but and it might not be on there, it would have been issued probably Thursday or Friday.
Yeah, I'll see what we get, so.
And how many snow violations?
Well, it's like there's no parking, I guess downtown, like there's those or so.
I believe on Thursday of last week, there was 8 warnings with tow tags, I think is how Kirk explained it to me, and then the next day, I think we issued 1 citation, no vehicles towed.
Yes, this is 6 of them, 2-hour parking and 5 for no parking, 11, 7, 1 for no parking on Thursday, if that's what we have, I'm sure we would want.
Anything for the sheriff's department? Got a good job?
Yep. Appreciate it.
Right, drive fast, your hands on the wheel.
I have to, thank you.
Anybody else for a public forum?
I guess I'd like to make a request that information on the length of time and the type of parking restricted be published or be expounded upon for the citizens of the city, I guess, just to re-remind them and just to provide clarity and avoid misunderstanding.
This policy isn't an emergency?
Yeah, it's not an emergency.
Where would you have that printed? Just a suggestion.
I don't know, I guess.
A website?
Some type of a, yeah, website, but just some type of a mailbox stuff or nothing else, just what.
It was on our water bills.
Yeah.
And.
Last two.
Yeah, the last two we put it on.
And the website will be presented to council at the next meeting, at our last meeting today on it, so that should make it easier.
The length of time and how soon you need to remove it, and, you know, 2 inches constitutes a snowfall, and, you know, just to expand upon, just to jog people's memory, I guess, just.
How often, or every 2 weeks?
No, I think once in a season, at the start of the season, should clarify it.
And what if their argument is, and I've had this argument 5 times, what if their argument is, I don't read the local paper?
Well, like I said, the local mailbox stuff.
I've had real lengthy discussions with, you know,
what proper notification is in there.
And I didn't realize it, but I went back and looked, it was on 2 water bills. This is November and December.
I never told them.
I don't like that, that was my experience.
There's a limit of how much you can put on the water rail too.
That's correct. Anyone else on public forum? Okay. Should we go down to new paper, get new paper right away? You go to it.
I think we can do that stuff pretty quickly too, so.
Old business, downtown revitalization project.
We had a committee meeting this evening. 2 things that I'll bring everybody's attention. We did determine that we are going to order 24-by-8-inch signage blades for our street signage for the downtown. And it'd probably be my goal that we look to come up with a plan to incorporate those into the rest of the community on a yearly basis, however many we want to deem that we're going to put out. Those will be made by Prison Industries at a cost of just over $30. And we should have those, if we finalize the order tomorrow, we should have them in 30 days. The other item is a downtown grand opening, if you will. We're going to do 2 events that we're going to help participate in. The first one's going to be the Thursday night of the opening of the quilt show, which would be, Ken, you're going to have to correct me on the date. It's going to be April 20.
Last Thursday in April.
Yeah, it doesn't.
28th.
Yeah. Yep, 28th. That evening, we're going to look to try to capitalize on having those individuals in town and try to show them a little bit about what we've done in the downtown, some of our literature. We did take 1 step closer to finalizing our downtown quilt walk brochure, which we'll give each of those individuals so they can know what the downtown's about. As well as we'll look to hopefully incorporate having some of the kids do some, the local school, decorate sugar cookies with quilts like what you see surrounding this room. We can give those to those individuals and the public that show up for that kind of small-scale grand opening. We would look to do a larger grand opening the weekend of Kalona Days, which I couldn't tell you what that date's going to be. I don't think the chamber's decided yet. But we'll have that date shortly. And we'll look to do something a little more substantial and try to get the committee's input as to what that's going to be that Friday night, Saturday. A lot of that's going to be based on how Kalona Days looks this year as to what activities are going to be hosted by the chamber and the city. That's all I've got in downtown.
Any other questions on that?
The banners are all in too, by the way. So all of these are done. So everything you see here will be put up when weather permits. We've got all the brackets. They look very good. And we'll start working on directional signage as well. We can come up with something that everybody deems appropriate.
Okay. We have a public hearing on the 2010-2011 budget. We'll open the public hearing. Were there any written comments? Is there anyone here to comment on the budget amendment? No, we'll close the public hearing. And if the council wants to take action, it'll get a resolution amending the current budget. That was discussed on January 17th. Make a motion.
Do you have anything else?
No.
If nothing else, I'll make a motion. We go with the amended budget.
Second. The motion and the second on the resolution amending the current budget for fiscal year ending June 30th, 2011. Roll call, please.
Bentley is absent. Herington?
Yes.
Lafaurie?
Yes.
Miller-Zahradnek absent. Robe?
Yes.
Motion carried.
This might be a short meeting.
Report by city administrator.
The only thing I want to touch base on is snow removal. Actually, two things. Snow removal. Obviously, we were hit with 15, 16 inches of snow last week. The guys did a wonderful job getting the snow not only off the streets but out of the downtown, out of the visibility of the roadways, getting the snow moved so that people could pull up to Highway 22 and not have to edge out onto the road to see if they could pass. So with that, we had a substantial amount of hours and a fairly substantial cost that's associated with getting all that done. Man hours, we incurred roughly 124 hours to get that done. The amount of hours that we put on the backhoe, we looked at roughly 47. We had 26 hours on the road grader and probably 41 hours in trucks. Combined total or estimates for what the bills are going to be when they start coming in, we're looking at roughly $11,700 for assistance in backhoe operation to get those areas that we could not get with the grader and or the blade on the trucks. And one was not going to cut it as far as just ours. And a substantial amount for hauling to get the snow out of here. So all said and done, that's about $11,700.
How's that look compared to our budget for the year, Ryan?
You know, I didn't even look at it this afternoon, to be real honest. We got these numbers so late, I didn't have a chance to look. So I apologize for that.
It was an excellent, excellent job. I have not heard any negative comments. I will comment about the city help. They did a fantastic job. They rescued the mayor and pulled him out. I couldn't get out of my driveway. He cleared the maintainer, pulled me out.
Don't worry, you'll get your bill for that.
He probably driveway shut today, so.
Bill. The only other thing I had is the Kauffman Fire Department is going to, or is inviting the council to their trustees meeting, which will be 6 p.m. on March 1st at the fire station for the mayor, city manager, and town council. Clerk? 6 p.m.
That's good.
Very good. Yes, that's all I had.
Okay, under new business, FEMA, DNR, we have, I don't know what I got, it's Jason, I didn't get anybody else's name.
We've got three individuals here this evening. Monique Pilch from FEMA, Region 7, Jason Kahn with the DNR, and Garrett Skinner with STAR. Garrett's group did the mapping we're going to be looking at here shortly, so. Jason, did you want to start?
Sure.
There's a remote over there for your presentation.
Okay. Where's like, somewhere?
No, that one right there.
Where would you like me to stand?
Wherever, that's fine, right there.
I stand over here, so
yep.
I want to take a look at me in the presentation as well. Well, thank you for inviting us here tonight to present to the City Council about discussing participation in the National Flood Insurance Program. As I said, my name is Jason Kahn. I'm with the Iowa Department of Natural Resources in Des Moines. I am in the local floodplains program, which helps communities enroll into the National Flood Insurance Program and do a lot with floodplain development permits at the DNR and a lot of technical assistance for map changes and permits as well. So my presentation will be basically just on the National Flood Insurance Program, benefits of thereof, and how the city can join the NFIP, as we like to call it. Yeah, okay, that's all right. Make it a little bit shorter. So, what my first slide says, for some reason it doesn't want to...
Yeah, I couldn't get that back here, sorry.
Whatever. The National Flood Insurance Program was actually created by Congress in 1968, due in large part because at one time private insurance companies did provide flood insurance, but it became cost prohibitive for the private entity to keep providing flood insurance. So Congress enacted the National Flood Insurance Program in 1968. More importantly, though, they amended the program in 1973, and the most important of that amendment was the mandatory purchase of flood insurance for structures with federally backed loans located in the area of the special flood hazard area, which is generally known as 100-year floodplain. And Monique will be presenting more on the mandatory purchase requirements later. So the National Flood Insurance Program is really a voluntary program based on a mutual agreement between the federal government and local community. In exchange for adopting and enforcing a floodplain management ordinance, FEMA provides federally subsidized flood insurance available to all property owners within that particular community. The NFIP is much more than flood insurance, though. FEMA provides a vast array of disaster assistance and grants and loans, especially for structures located in that special flood hazard area. So, federal agencies such as the EPA, Small Business Administration, Housing and Urban Development, Fannie and Freddie Mac, both communities that do not participate in the program, if they have structures located in the special flood hazard area, these special grants and loans cannot be extended to these structures located in the floodplain. In exchange for all that, like I said, a floodplain management ordinance is required, and permits are required for development that are constructed in that area of the special flood hazard area. And the intent is to really to prevent increased damage associated with flooding, protect new buildings, and reduce the severity of flooding in the community. This is just looking statewide here in Iowa. Currently, there are about 560 communities that do participate in the state with over 17,000 flood insurance policies statewide, with and that has a $2.6 billion coverage. And since 1978, there has been $250 million in claims, $250 million paid on 10,800 claims. Now, the number of claims and number of policies has jumped here in Iowa, especially since the flooding statewide in 2008 and 2010. One of the things we like to point out in the National Flood Insurance Program is because it's our big thing is providing flood insurance to the property owners in your community, we like to kind of do a comparison between flood insurance and versus disaster assistance. Actually, there are 20% of all claims are made for structures outside of that special flood hazard area, so beyond the limits of the 100-year floodplain. With flood insurance, residential structures can purchase up to $250,000 in coverage. Non-residential structures can purchase up to $500,000 in coverage. Contents coverage is also available. And through the National Flood Insurance Program, policies cannot be canceled for repeat losses or repeat claims. With disaster assistance, a presidential disaster declaration must be declared in order for that federal disaster assistance to be made available in that community affected by flooding. And only 50% of flood events are presidentially declared disasters. Disaster assistance is in the form of a loan that must be repaid with interest. This is on a nationwide scale, but the average reward with a disaster repayment is $4,000. And recipients of disaster aid are usually required to carry flood insurance for the amount of that payment.
After the payment?
That's after they receive the payment, correct. So how do communities actually join the program? Well, for a simple community that has a FEMA flood insurance rate map, and at this point, Kalona does not have an effective floodplain map. The one that the city received back in September is a preliminary map. It's not quite yet effective. That map will become effective on September 29th of this year. So in order to join the program, like I said, an ordinance is required, which regulates development in the floodplain. A permit is required for new development to be constructed. And we have set standards in that ordinance that what must be adhered to, which is set through that permit.
Is that a local permit?
It is a local permit. It's a good question. Actually, for communities that have approximate studies, and Kauffman is a community with approximate study on their preliminary map, they are required to get a permit from the Iowa DNR in addition to the local permit. The most important thing is that you have to designate a local official to administer the program in your community. So, I apologize. With Kelowna, because there is no effective map right now as we speak, I promise I'm not touching the button. Currently, wow.
I wonder if you're on play.
Oh, am I?
I bet you are. Here, let me restart it and I'll get you to that.
Go okay.
Ahead. Just use this. When you do it.
Okay. Currently, there is no effective map in effect for Kelowna. So in order for the city to join, it's fairly simple. Right now, an ordinance would not be required for the city to join. All that would be required would be a one-page resolution of intent and a one-page application form. The purpose of the resolution of intent is it basically allows the community to recognize that flood hazards exist within their community and that they evaluate those flood hazards when you conduct land use planning. And you have to designate in the resolution of intent the local official responsible for administering the program. We have templates of these documents, both the resolution and the application, at the DNR, so we can provide you to. I actually have hard copies here tonight if you'd like me to leave them with you. So that's all that required. Okay, so participating in the state of Iowa. I apologize. FEMA sets a minimum standard, a but they allow the states to adopt more stringent standards. Well, in Iowa, the state of Iowa has decided that they would adopt a standard of new development going inside the special flood hazard area must be protected to 1 foot above the 100-year flood elevation. And as I stated earlier, because there are approximate 70 floodplains here in the community on the preliminary map issued last September, a permit would be required prior to the local permit for floodplain development. The DNR needs to review and concur on all variants issued on the ordinance if we get to that point. Once these new maps become effective in September, an ordinance would be required for the community to stay in good standing with FEMA. And that any map changes, which I'll get here in a minute to, if map amendments, map revisions, they need to be reviewed and concurred by the DNR prior to the review. So here's a list of some of the services we provide. We obviously help communities enroll and participate in the National Flood Insurance Program. We have model ordinances, model resolutions for you to adopt. We do compliance visits with communities that participate to ensure that they are living up to their requirements in the ordinance. We do a lot of technical assistance with insurance, with issuing local permits, with project development. We do a lot of outreach and training with the help of FEMA. We hold workshops on an annual basis here for local officials, kind of a floodplain management 101. So map changes. Maps are something that change because new and better technology is being created all the time. So when better, more accurate data is available, we'd like to have those maps be updated. So there's a process. One is a letter of a map amendment. This is actually for houses, structures that are inadvertently included in the floodplain. In this little simple graphic that I have here, here's a nice little yellow house on the edge of the floodplain. Say the property owner disagrees with the map, they need to hire a surveyor to shoot the elevation of their most adjacent grade on the structure compared to the 100-year flood elevation on the floodplain map. And if it's at or above the 100-year flood elevation, a letter of map amendment will be issued from FEMA to the community and to the property owner. Natural ground has to be at or higher than the 100-year flood elevation. Now, if you want to actually physically change the map, this is called a letter of map revision. This is where you actually do something in the community, whether it's a reservoir, a dike, or a levee, channel change, something that changes the physical characteristics of the flooding source. This is where a letter of map revision would be applied for. You're actually placing fill along the bank. This is where you're actually changing the physical characteristics, as I said. An engineering firm will need to be hired in order to show the difference from the existing map and what the changes are resulting from the structure that the city has placed. This is costly. It takes money to hire an engineering firm. FEMA charges a fee to review the application for a letter of map revision. And as I said, all map revisions must be reviewed and concurred at the DNR as well. I didn't mention, but the letter of map amendment does not have a fee associated with it. So just to do a quick comparison, letter of map amendment is to remove structures that are mistakenly shown in the floodplain. It requires a fairly simple form that a surveyor can fill out called the MTEZ form, and the cost review is free. The map revision is much more expensive, much more timely, much more extensive as far as revising the map. And I'd be glad to take any questions. Here's my contact information. I have business cards with me. Anyone has any questions about actually getting the city into the National Flood Insurance Program? I know we have a lot of information here in front of you tonight.
People outside the hazard area can buy flood insurance?
Once the city is participating, yes.
Right. And if they're outside, is it still similar cost or same cost?
Let me address this.
Yeah.
We actually have some forms up here or in your cost comparison sheet. That form is not included in your packet there. You'll also see comparable costs in the cost comparison sheet under preferred risk policy because we have over 20% of our losses that occur in low to moderate flood risk zones. We do recommend that folks still consider purchasing flood insurance coverage, and as long as they meet our limited loss history requirement, those would be the fees that they should look to expect in such a policy. So it's found on the far left-hand side. Okay, and there's a special handout back here that just says preferred risk policy if you would like to have one of those.
And you said you used the 100-year, not the 500-year flood?
We matched the 100-year flood, correct. That's where all the mandatory purchase requirements are based off of. That's all the standards set in the ordinances that cities must adopt.
So what reason would we not be involved?
That's a very good question. With the community joining at this time, the next 6 weeks, they would be able to join underneath the regular phase, and citizens would be able to take advantage of that preferred risk rate. And Monique will touch on that in detail. Participating in the National Flood Insurance Program opens up a lot of doors as far as mitigation opportunities as well. FEMA has a lot of mitigation programs out there to help mitigate future flood losses. Obviously, federally subsidized flood insurance is a big key there.
As a council, if we become involved, we're going to force people that have bank loans to have to buy the insurance. So it's going to cost some people money.
Correct.
It's like any insurance. If something happens, you're tickled to death, you got it. If nothing happens, it costs you money. So again, what reason would we not be involved? I mean, we're going to cost people money if we do this. I'm not saying it's bad, don't get me wrong, but is there a reason why we wouldn't as a community?
As a community, I think what you have to look at is, okay, we recognize that with the preliminary mapping data, there is a greater level of risk. Okay, that's being represented on the maps. And so with that in mind, knowing that the community is potentially going to participate in the program, then that, at that point, opens up an opportunity for a level of risk management to take place. Okay, we recognize there's a higher level of risk to our constituents. Now, what can we do to make sure that they have some sort of resource to cover themselves as a result of that risk now being identified? The way, since the community does not currently participate, if you choose to continue doing so, but you understand that there is this heightened level of risk, then at that point you have left your constituents with no or very limited opportunity not only to cover that heightened risk that we now know exists, but also there's a limitation of certain federal types of resources that would be available, such as federal disaster aid that would then come forth as a result of we now knowing a half, if not three quarters of the community in the high-risk flood zone area. So you've limited not only an opportunity to get coverage through flood insurance, but also an opportunity to obtain coverage through federal disaster assistance. Not all of it, but some federal disaster assistance.
That risk has always been here. And how often have we had damage from flooding in Kelowna? Because the risk changes as you develop, and I understand all that. But that risk has been here forever, as long as Kelowna's been here. We're built on a flat plain with a river and creeks going through. So it's always been here, and we've never had serious problems yet. Not that it won't happen. I'm playing devil's advocate. Mm-hmm. It's not that I'm against this. Mm-hmm. This is what I'm going to hear.
Right. Can you also maybe allude to some of the potential mortgage restrictions? If the community chooses not to participate,
absolutely,
and the maps are adopted, which absolutely, they're going to be adopted.
Yeah. Absolutely. So, with respect to lending institutions, how this works, we have a statutory requirement. And what the statute said is for those structures that are identified in a high-risk flood zone area, if a person would like to utilize a federally regulated or federally insured loan, or like to get one of those, they cannot get one in a non-participating community. Okay? because the statute says that the person, any person that uses a qualifying collateral, which for us is a structure with two sides and a secured roof and a foundation, if they have that and it's federally backed, then they, and it's in a high-risk flood zone area, so a half to three-quarters of your structures, then they have to have flood insurance. Okay? So there will be a serious limitation as a result of that. In addition to that, we have to look, I believe there's a couple of lending institutions, is that correct, that
there's
are here?
There's two locally.
There are two locally. So what will happen for them is they are also now, probably by their regulating agencies, are going to be asked to go through and look. They're going to say, okay, we recognize that now there is identified risk for a lot of these structures that already have mortgages on them. I think you need to reassess your portfolio and make sure that it is the exact type of risk that you are wanting in your book of business. So we have a big piece here that your lenders here in your community are going to have to work with now. If flood insurance is available because you choose to participate in our program, then of course, then they can go through and they can work to comply with the statutory requirement. And it will become available to everyone and they can continue to move forward with business as they have in the past.
Is it true that if, let's say, hypothetically, this council decided we're not going to do this, that those lenders would still require individuals that are now in the floodplain to get floodplain insurance, except that since we're not participating with FEMA, that cost to them would be way more excessive.
Exponentially?
Yeah, what's the...
Here's what happens, because it looks... Okay, so if you choose to continue not participating and the risk is identified, because flood insurance is not available, we can't mandate it. Okay, we can't force it under the NFIP in that scenario. Okay? However, lenders may have contractual authority to require a coverage outside of that statute, so they might require that those existing borrowers identified in a high-risk area go outside of our minimum requirements and at that point purchase coverage from some other entity. Did that make sense?
Yeah, is there an exponent? You said exponentially, so.
You know, I can't say specifically. And the reason why is because that's another line of industry. I mean, that's okay. Outside of us and the NFIP. What I can say is that often we see a trend that it is significantly higher in premium than what one can find under the National Flood Insurance Program. Why? Because we have a larger number of policies, sure. And so we're able to extend that risk among a larger population than a private carrier.
And you said on new construction, if it's in the hazard area, there would be a review by the city and by DNR, and people would be required to build 1 foot above the 100-year flood level.
Yes.
Did I hear that correct?
That is correct, yes. We actually, there's also language in our flood management ordinance that regulates what we call substantial improvements and substantial damages. So with a substantial improvement, if you increase the floor area by 25% or more of an existing structure, that substantial improved area has to be appropriately protected. Substantially damaged. Damage can come from a tornado, a fire, any type of natural disaster event, and including flood. If the damage of the structure is more than 50% of the current market value on that structure, so the cost of repairing that structure to its pre-disaster or pre-damage value, if it's more than 50% of the market value, it has to be elevated or protected in some way to 1 foot above the 100-foot elevation.
Is that the first floor, we call it, or what happens?
The first floor, yes. Including basement.
And NFIP covers no basement contents and or...
It does have some coverage in the basement, and Monique can fill you in on that. But, there is coverage.
A I was looking for a brochure out here. Yes, so there are coverages available for basements. What I really like people to try and focus on is when we're looking at coverage, what's more important, our contents or the structure? Okay, so when we're talking about the structure, we're talking about there's coverage for the foundation and the mechanical components. Now, it might not fit the exact same wallpaper that we had up there before, but that's not a key component, right? Really, what we're looking at is the most costly piece is the foundation and the mechanical aspect. Now, with respect to contents, yes, there is limited coverage available. Okay, we have three. Let's look up here and see what resources we have in here. Okay, the summary of coverage form right here. Okay, everyone has one of those in here. What I would like for you to refer to is if you open it up, you can start to see, okay, in the center section, some of the coverages that are available. Or on page 3, you will see right in the center there, those are three primary areas here. The washer and dryers, food freezers and food in them, and portable window AC units. So when we're talking about content coverage, those are the limitations that do exist for basements. Okay, but the structure itself, the foundation is covered, the mechanical aspects are covered, all of those key costly components that we do need to have in order to have that structure up and functioning to its pre-damaged state.
Question for you, Jason.
Yeah.
I don't understand for sure what the scope is statewide with the new mapping and what kind of load is being put on the DNR for some kind of development from this, but I do understand that there is quite a backlog and it may be associated with the floods in 2008 and 2010. And what I understand, it's not uncommon for somebody to wait 3 months or more to have a floodplain development permit reviewed and approved or whatever. How is the DNR addressing this if there's any big load? Well, maybe staffing better for that. Or?
Yes. In the 2009 legislative session, the DNR was actually, the floodplain management section of the DNR was given additional money to hire additional review engineers to specifically reduce and eliminate our backlog. And you're right, from 2008, the backlog of projects just increased substantially. A lot of it had to do with damage structures, channel changes, you know, banks just being blown out. We have actually reduced that to just a few dozen backlog projects. You know, we're talking about pre-2007 projects. A lot of the newer projects have been tied to federal and state money due to the American Reinvestment Act. You know, projects associated with that had any type of floodplain review got first priority because the federal and state dollars were tied to those projects. But, yeah. Like I said, additional staff has been hired and the project backlog has been reduced. And we've also streamlined our review process. So the review engineers sat down for a couple of days and reviewed their process, how they actually take projects in and review them and issue permits. That's been revamped, it's more streamlined. So right now, I think when you actually submit a completed application, and I will stress completed application, it's probably about 4 to 6, 8 weeks out, maybe sometimes for a permit, depending on what it is. You know, if it's a bridge project, that's gonna take a lot longer because of all the engineering modeling that goes into a review of that project. But if it's for an individual structure going in, like in the city of Kelowna, a brand new house in the floodplain that needs just a simple permit from the DNR and to establish 100-year flood elevation for that site, that's something that can be taken care of in a matter of weeks.
probably isn't likely going to be something the city would use on the county, right?
You know, we do have what we call a floodplain hotline. And it is an 800 number that is just basically a general technical assistance line that anyone can call in on any type of floodplain-related project. And I apologize, I don't have it in my presentation, but it is listed on our website at floodplain.iowa.dnr.gov. And anyone who's open to call the number, it puts you right in contact with the staff that reviews permits for the DNR.
Okay, Jason, would you explain a little bit further the resolution of intent? You said that could be accomplished now within the next 6 or 8 weeks, and that actually would that or actually accomplish the community as being a participating member then?
Yes. Yeah, if once it's adopted by the council, they'll provide it back to the DNR. I will review it, make sure it's in order, compliant, and I will forward it on FEMA for recommendation for enrollment into the
So national. Then the city would still need to adopt the map when that is adopted?
Yes.
And develop a full-fledged floodplain management ordinance?
Correct. Okay. And that would be required, say the city decides a month from now they want to join. So in a month from now they will need to adopt that resolution of intent, complete the one phrase application form, return it back to the DNR. I review it, forward it on to FEMA. FEMA actually enrolls the city into the National Furniture Program. It's their program. When the maps become effective on September 29th of 2011, if the city is already in the program at that time, come this fall, in order to remain in good standing with the NFIP, FEMA will require you, you being the city, to adopt a floodplain management ordinance. Because these maps are only preliminary at this point. So Kauffman does not have an effective floodplain map as we speak today. But those preliminary maps that were issued last September, they will come effective on September 29th. And if you're already in the program, come September 1st, 2011, before those maps become effective, the city will be required to adopt the floodplain management ordinance to remain in the program. Because flood hazards have been identified in your community officially on a flood insurance rate map produced by FEMA.
Are there financial advantages to the cost of the insurance if we adopt this soon versus waiting that will allow people to get policies at a preferred rate for a period of 2 years?
Yes, that's an excellent question, and we're actually going to go through that in the slide check here in just a moment.
Okay. One additional question. You noted on the communities in Iowa, there were like 46 that were emergency communities. Now, would you explain what those communities are?
That has to do with the type of map a community has, and it's tied to insurance coverage. Communities that participate in the emergency phase of the National Flood Insurance Program have what is called a flood hazard boundary map. And most of those types of maps were produced in the very early stages of the National Flood Insurance Program. So a lot of those maps were produced in the early and mid-70s, with the 1970s. And it was the intent back then was, we'll produce these flood hazard boundary maps, we'll come back later do a much more detailed analysis of a community's flood hazards. When FEMA determined that conducting detailed studies in communities was much more cost effective than they once had thought, and you kind of fill me in on this, Monique, but they left those communities that didn't have a flood insurance rate map in the emergency phase. And it's tied to insurance, so there's communities that participate in the emergency phase can buy less coverage than those in the regular phase. And I will note, and Monique will mention this as well, when the community joins, they will join underneath the regular phase of the program, which will allow your property owners to purchase the full amount of coverage that the National Flood Insurance Program has to offer.
So the emergency ones are actually participating.
They are participating.
What happens if, since this is a preliminary map, when the final comes out in September, what if we have a lot of problems with the new map.
We disagree.
Things have changed drastically for one reason or another. What are our options at that point?
With respect of changing or revising the map?
Or with respect of staying in the program if we're in disagreement with the map?
You can definitely have property owners go the route of a map amendment. If they believe that their natural ground around their structure is at or above the 100-year flood elevation, then they can submit that MTEZ form to FEMA with the hopes of having a letter map amendment issued. Now, if the city wants to look at a mitigation project, something like a detention pond or a reservoir or a dike or a levee, then you'd have to go through a physical map revision and go through the process of hiring an engineering firm to conduct that study, submit the thing for physical map revision, which would actually produce a new floodplain map for the community.
You're talking to Iowa Flood Center late this afternoon. Should we partner with them? That would be something that if they do those, they would physically do the calculations to show what changes that would do and make for that mapping. So that's something they would look at closely.
Well, if there's no other questions, I will turn it over to Monique. And I thank you for your time.
Okay, what's the special button?
Okay, don't press this button.
Do not press that. Stick up there. Okay. All right. So I just want to make everyone aware. You can't really see it the way that it's represented up on the big screen here, but all of these pictures that you're going to see through here are from the 2008 Iowa flooding. So it's across Iowa. This is not down south. This is not on one of the coasts. This is instead right here in your very own state. So what we're going to visit on are some of the effects of map changes on flood insurance. It's kind of hard to see there, but my contact information is on there. So I want you to feel very comfortable either asking me questions during this open session right now, after the session, or you can email or call me. Okay, so please feel free to do that. For those of you that can't see it, it is 816-283-7980. So let's move forward. What we're going to talk just briefly on is the impact of map changes, some of the NFIP cost-saving options, and then just give you some map-changing resources so that you will have that later to help assist in educating and informing your constituents. All right. So, Jason did go through and visit a little bit about the mapping process. I always think this is informational to communities not fully aware of our map study life cycle. So, we do have the project scoping, the initial involvement, so that helps us to identify code. Is there a need to identify a risk in a community? Do we need to reassess it? So, that's our initial involvement. Then comes the time when they start to do some of the data collection. So they start to develop it and do some initial stakeholder outreach. Well, here's where we are right now in the preliminary release process. So we're out here, we're visiting with the impacted stakeholders. We visited with some of the media earlier, and we're doing our public outreach so that we can make sure that each of you as a community and your constituents are best informed. And then moving forward, I believe it was September 29th. Are we shedding these? Sure. September 29th is when we're looking to have the adoption of these, or at least the effective date, depending on how your community moves forward, but the effective date of those preliminary maps will take place. All right, I thought you might find this insightful to actually be able to view on there how some of the other counties are being mapped and what process they're in. So if we look at the pink section, those are the counties that are currently in the preliminary process. So if we look at the actual cities themselves, we've got about 220 communities in that preliminary process, or about 21 counties as a whole, one of which is yours. All right, and then we can also look as a whole, if we look at the pinks, the yellows, and the greens, those are all communities that are either in the mapping revision process or have recently had new maps go effective. All right, so the impact of map change as well. The maps are changing, right? As Jason mentioned, we have new resources that allow us to capture more technical data, more accurate information on the maps. We know that the risk of flooding is real. We don't have to look outside Iowa. We have our neighbors, our families, and our friends that have been recently impacted by flooding. Flood map changes do have insurance implications. We will look at exactly what those implications are here in just a moment. And we do want to make sure that we understand the possible cost-saving options that exist. And new maps equal safe communities. Why? Because with the new maps, we can actually identify the most current risk that exists, the most current information we have that identifies the risk. And with that, we can move forward to do, here's our little motto that we have over in our mitigation division. Our objective is to reduce loss of lives and property damage. That's our goal. All right, insurance benefits of new maps. Well, we're able to identify current flood hazards. It better delineates the base flood elevation, or as Jason said, that's that 1% annual chance of flooding in any given year. Provides for more accurate rating, and it allows our property owners or your constituents to make more informed decisions. All right, so here's what we really want to get into. So there was some discussion earlier about the preferred risk policy. So this is where it gets a little confusing. So start waving your hands around and asking questions for sure if I start moving through this too quickly. The preferred risk policy offers low-cost flood insurance to owners and tenants of eligible residential and non-residential buildings. So, as we talked about earlier, this is our preferred risk policy right here, right? It's pretty cost-affordable, or on this cost comparison sheet. It is that section on the far left-hand side. So, if you were to join the program here pretty soon, okay, so go ahead and get on in, all of your properties are showing in a low to moderate flood risk now. Anybody could get it now.
Okay. Well, most of our properties, there are some that are probably not in that already.
All of them are in SFHA in this community right now, correct? The structures.
Currently now.
Yes. So right now.
Only because we didn't adopt it. We don't have any other maps.
Right. So if we go ahead and do that right away, not with the preliminary maps, but with the current information, okay, then that's where it would fall, and they would be eligible for that. Okay?
Now that's prior to September 29th.
This is prior to September. This is prior to September. Okay. All right. So let's go ahead and look at this. Here's an example. So $75,000 in building coverage, $30,000 in content coverage is $277 annually. Okay, this is for a 1-4 residential structure. That's pretty cost affordable. Here's another example, $250,000 in building coverage, $100,000 in content coverage. Let's go worst case scenario with a basement or enclosure, $405.
That's not what these
figures are. $10
off.
Yeah. They could be $10 off if it's not including some of the fees that are associated. There's a lot of little notes down at the bottom. And we did have a recent increase. These coverages are effective January 1, 2011.
And These are May 2010.
Mm-hmm. There we go. So that could be what our discrepancy is.
Yeah,
$10. I know, it's going to break us. So our rates tend to change at least 2 times a year potentially, and then we had an additional one with this new implementation, which I'm getting ready to talk about. So something else I'd like you to be aware of, it's not just available for 1-4 family single residential structures, but it's also available for other residential structures, such as apartments, and for non-residential buildings, such as our commercial buildings. Okay?
At the same rate? At the same rate?
There's a different cost comparison up here. Mm-hmm. There are different coverages, absolutely. Now the other residential maxes out at $250,000. Okay, all residential structures max out at $250,000 in building and $100,000 in content. But the non-residential building or our commercial type buildings, they have coverage available up to $500,000 in both content and building coverage. All right, so now we're going to visit on the preferred response. Yes.
Commercial rate.
Yes.
You got some up there?
I did. Uh-huh.
Give me a couple.
100,000.
Absolutely. So if we have 100,000 in building coverage and 100,000 in content coverage, $1,530. And I'm going to give you the maximum in both, so 500,000 in content, 500,000 in building, 4,252. Okay.
And those are not preferred.
These are preferred rates.
So those would be subject to change at some point.
This is under the preferred risk policy with a structure in a low to moderate flood risk zone. Okay, so we're going to talk about what's going to happen with some potential changes to those structures, okay? Now, here's where we have to bump it up a notch, okay? So I told you about the preferred risk policy, right? So they have to be in a low to moderate flood risk. The next part, Congress authorized what's called the preferred risk policy, or PRP, eligibility extension. Now what that is that allows property owners that are newly mapped into a high-risk flood zone area, so that would be a significant portion of your properties, okay, to have some temporary financial relief that from the burden of having to purchase flood insurance, maybe as a result of the mandatory purchase requirement. Okay? So let's talk about exactly what that means. Okay. In this particular case, if a property was newly mapped, and this is why it's so critical, okay, why you should go ahead and apply to the program prior to the September map revision that's to take place. Okay? Because if you wait until after that to join the program, your property owners are not going to be newly mapped. They are just going to be in the high-risk flood zone. Okay? So, if a property is newly mapped into the high-risk flood zone on or after October 1st of 2008, the structure will be eligible for the lower cost preferred risk policy for up to 2 years, in your case, of the mapping revision that takes place or the effective date of the map revision. So, if we have a map revision that takes place September 29th of 2011, your property owners would be eligible for the preferred risk policy eligibility extension for 2 years immediately following that map change. Okay? So that would be through September 29th of 2013. Okay? In the past, what would happen before Congress authorized the eligibility extension, a person had to purchase a PRP prior to the map change. If they didn't do that, then they weren't eligible for it at all. Or, if they did do it, they only got it for 1 year. Okay? Now Congress is saying, no, We're going to let them have it up to 2 years, and they can buy it after the map has taken place. But that eligibility extension period is still 2 years immediately following that effective date. Yes?
Now, would that give you that rate forever or only for the 2 years?
For 2 years. And here's what's going to happen. Let's move forward. And here's where our cost comparison sheet kind of helps us out. Because it's more like a... Alright, so we're going to start off, and this will be a little bit different example, but it kind of follows the same pattern, how this cost comparison is set up. So after 2 years, that 2 year eligibility period, so that first box there on the far left, okay, so there's a rate right there. Alright, after that, and this is for... After 2 years, it's going to go to a grandfathered policy, okay? So that middle section there. And this is a little bit different example setup, so the rates aren't going to match exactly, but it gives you an idea. That first section they'll get for 2 years, or in the one on the far left. And then in the middle here is the grandfathered premium, okay? So what they're going to get to grandfather in is not the rate, but instead the flood zone designation. Okay, never grandfather in a rate, but we can grandfather in the flood zone designation. Okay, and you're thinking, well, Mimi, that went up significantly. How is that helping our constituents? Okay, if grandfathering did not exist, then they would be rated at $2,563. Okay, so let's come up with an example. Let's say you decide to wait. Let's say that you want to not or postpone joining the program until after September. Okay, then your constituents would only be eligible for the not grandfathered section. Or on your cost comparison here, that far right hand side. So not only is it important that you go ahead and join the program now to take advantage of this, go ahead and show that those, you have some sort of mapping data reflecting that the structures are in a non-special flood hazard area, so you can take advantage of the preferred rates and the grandfathering. It would prevent you from having to pay the non-grandfathered rates later. Now,
can you touch base, and you may later tell me to hold off, but
okay.
That grandfathered rate is on the property. So
on the structure?
On the structure.
Yes.
So an individual, I carried mine for 12 months, sell my house, mm-hmm. that could be carried over to the next property owner.
Yes. At the approval of the existing policyholder, if they sell the home later, then at that point, they can request that that policy be transferred over to that new borrower or that new homeowner. And they, too, can take advantage of this. So it's a marketing tool. Because if me and my neighbor have the same one, and I've locked it in and grandfathered it in, then mine might be a little easier.
But if somebody in Zone A doesn't have a mortgage, doesn't choose to participate in the program, sells their property, the next homeowner has a mortgage on it, all bets are off, it's non-grandfathered.
If it's outside that eligibility time period.
Years, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes. And so then they would come in at the non-grandfathered rate.
So yeah, it's $200 a month to their mortgage if they have a $200,000 building with $80,000 in contents.
Yes.
Or even instead of being 28, it's 150 bucks.
Okay. Any other questions before we move forward? Okay, so just a reminder, you know, we talk a lot about the different things, but just a reminder, in order for them to be eligible for the eligibility extension, they must be in a BC, we don't have any D zones over here, so BC or X zone, which is where your properties are located at now if you go ahead and join the program prior to the September map, okay? And again, we have to show them being newly mapped into one of those A or B zones, and it would be going, the preliminary map showing that your structures are going into an A zone. We do also have a limited loss history requirement that exists.
You had an AB on the other rate back a slide, and
okay.
So you're saying we're in the A zone now,
yes.
Or the AB zone?
You, in the preliminary maps, it's showing A.
Okay, so that former slide with the other rates, mm-hmm. is that both for A and AB, or is AB a higher rate?
Any of the ones with A's are high risk. So that was just an example, just like the cost comparison is an example across the board. The only thing that an E shows is that elevations are available. And
okay.
So your mapping is a little bit different.
Can you compare apples to apples on another slide? Can you move back a slide?
Okay. Let's get our little arrows going back. Okay.
I mean, the grandfather there is X zone. And you show A E zone over on the not grandfather. I mean, is that
right.
Apples to apples or not?
Right, because what happens is here, it's in the B, C, or X zone, right? This is the way it's being rated. It's grandfathered in here, so you get to retain the X zone. If you're not grandfathered, then you're going to be rated in the actual risk in which you're located, which is A E. Does that make, do you understand that?
Yeah.
It's very confusing, but this allows you to grandfather it in at the low to moderate risk, even though the structure at this point is in a high-risk flood zone.
Okay.
So the risk in which the structure is located in is still high, but for rating purposes, we're going to allow you to rate at that
okay.
low to moderate flood risk. So just because you're getting rated for the low risk doesn't mean you're technically not in a high-risk flood zone designated area. Okay, so we'll move forward here. All right, so what are the benefits? Well, it helps to ease the transition of being newly mapped into the high-risk flood zone area. And of course, the challenge for your community is you have a couple of steps you would be going through. You would be joining the program. You would be immediately taking on mapping information that showed the low to moderate flood risk, but then in September it'd be going into high risk. So it's a little bit more complicated in this community. All right, we did talk a little bit about the mandatory purchase of flood insurance guidelines. So we did already visit on this a little bit. It does help to ease that burden that might moving forward. We also like to recognize that there is a marketing opportunity for your insurance professionals. And so we do have on our floodsmart.gov website, it's a consumer-friendly website that allows your insurance producers to be able to sell flood insurance in your community. And we give them some resources. If they take a class within a two-year time period, then they have an opportunity to actually be marketed on this website here. So they can ask to both be listed as an agent referral and utilize our co-op advertising resources. And of course, if you have insurance producers, they market on here. That brings money into the community, and it makes for a safer community. All right, so here we are. What are the benefits? Provides communities time to upgrade flood control structures and floodplain management. And all of these pictures are from Iowa. All right, so we have visited briefly on the grandfathering rules. So just a reminder, after the two-year eligibility period, when they move over, we don't lock in the rates, so when they move over from preferred rates to standard rates, so that middle column, that's when grandfathering kicks in, and they get to retain the more preferred flood zone designation.
Does that have a time frame on it?
No.
Okay.
So, until Congress or somebody
changes
the program,
okay.
then we can take advantage of that. And that's where the opportunity to transfer that policy over to to a new homeowner, step to advantage. All right, so some of our map change resources, of course, that top one there was the floodsmart.gov. That's an excellent resource. Folks can go into that website. They can get a little agent referral option in there, type in their zip code, and then they will populate for them agents within a close proximity of their residence. So they can specifically visit with insurance professionals. If you have additional questions on the PRP eligibility extensions, that's what that second one is there, under floodsmart.gov. I also went ahead and listed the NFIP homepage site. That's a great resource for engineers, surveyors, local government, insurance, and lending professionals. We also have FEMA's Map Service Center site there, as well as the 1-877 FEMA Map, which is the number to our FEMA's Map Information Exchange. The Map Service Center site will be a great resource for your community a little bit later. There should be future mapping data, which you can always go to Ryan. either the constituents or yourself can go to the Map Service Center site and look at the future mapping data, so the preliminary data, and that will probably be, I think we were thinking maybe around the latter part of June, that would become available. And then, of course, when it becomes effective, you'll be able to see it on that site as well. And then that very last bulletin down there, Insurance Outreach Toolkit for Flood Map Updates, that is a valuable resource to communities needing templates, press releases, templates to notify impacted property owners. There is a number of Q&A resources in there, so we don't want you to have to, work any harder. We have all the resources made available for you. Okay? You just have to retrieve it and then modify it accordingly and then notify the property owners. Okay? And I can leave that up there. The last slide just says questions. Do we have any questions? Ryan has this presentation, so if you do need to write down some of the resources a little bit later, you will have to contact myself or contact Jason at any time. And we're glad to visit with you about any of these things. Again, it is a lot to take in. I can present on some of this stuff for 4 hours, so to try and wrap it up into such a short period of time can be a little overwhelming. But please feel free to utilize us as a resource. Yeah.
One quick question.
Yes.
This right over here is for 2 years, from September 29th.
Yes.
And then you go this way.
Yes, as long as continuous coverage is maintained.
The key is continuous coverage.
Continuous coverage. Right. Now, I do just want to emphasize that this is an example, okay? Because any number of things can change, the outcome of this premium here. And we really do recommend that a property owner work with an insurance professional to identify the exact premium for their specific structure. But yes, this is a good example of comparatively what would happen.
Okay. Yeah. But is this general, how do I say this? If this is May of 2010, and you have The example you gave us was January 2011.
Mm-hmm. That was for the preferred risk policies here. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but that was $200,000 of exposure.
Mm-hmm.
Straight across the board,
mm-hmm.
It went up $400 in.
Yes. We have a variety of changes. Our program has two times a year, May 1st and October 1st, where we have major revisions that take place. And in this case, because of the preferred risk policy eligibility extension, we also had a change in January 1.
But that's 30%.
Well, this is for what we would have to look at. We have a number of variables that can change that. So I would have to look to see if this cost comparison is the same as those.
That's good. I'm thoroughly confused. That's okay.
And we can, what I would recommend that you look at is not these changes here, but across the board here. These are the cost comparisons.
I'm looking at where are we going with the rates.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're asking the homeowners to really change their budget.
Yes, yes. And, you know, I think we have to also look at the bigger picture. Again, yes, there is going to be a requirement, a mandatory requirement for flood insurance through the lending institutions. We also are aware that the risk is now identified and that if a property is impacted by flooding, $1,700 a year or $50,000 in damages to the structure. That's what we have to consider during these meetings and identify ultimately what would be in the best interest of your community and your constituents.
I agree.
Would these work for mobile homes too?
Yes, there is mobile home coverage. Okay. Now, we have
is that the same as this?
They do have coverage available to them. Yes, they would fall under the residential piece okay. here. What I would like to emphasize is that mobile homes, travel trailers, any of those must meet our strict floodplain management requirements. So there must be certain tie downs that exist, wheels taken off. They have to be firmly fixed to a permanent foundation. So there are a little different guidelines that exist for those types of buildings than a structure that would not fall under that classification.
So if somebody was purchasing a new mobile home and bringing it into one of our mobile home parks and we were to approve the mapping and become a part of the system, what would we tell an individual?
What the requirements are?
Would they have an application they have to fill out or something for that?
Yeah, once you join the program, we provide a sample, essentially floodplain development permits to the communities to use for issuing permits for floodplain development. And then upon that, you would have to direct them to the Iowa DNR to obtain a permit to get that 100 year flood elevation so they know how high they have to be elevated above natural ground, make sure the tie downs are on there.
So they would have to get a permit through the DNR?
DNR.
Before we could even allow them to place it in a mobile home park?
Correct. The permits are
which we don't permit now.
Yeah, the permit must be secured prior to construction.
Right.
Construction.
I have a question. This is Milka Cruz. Regarding the increased cost to people as a result of the mandatory insurance for federally backed mortgages, clearly if we participate as a community, there is that increased cost. I'm confused, however, is if we do not participate. It seemed that what you were saying was that even a non-participating community, lenders can choose to review their portfolios and require homeowners.
Contractually, they may have that authority.
Yes, to ensure in some way or the other that collateral. Do you have a feel for the probability of that happening? Because it sounds like even if we don't participate, there is some chance that we will incur, just as a result of having the mapping done, homeowners with federally backed mortgages and stuff might incur extra costs. Do you have a feel for the probability of that happening?
No.
I mean, it's not like if we don't participate, then clearly no one will have to buy insurance.
Right.
It sounds like there's some chance that it will happen.
There is an opportunity for that. You know, really, I can't say because...
But that's a bank. That's a question to ask a banker.
Exactly, exactly. Right. Because they are the ones that would have to assess their portfolio, or they are the ones that would have to justify that heightened risk in that portfolio to their regulators when they come through for auditing purposes. So that's, again, something.
Okay. Do you know where that question can be directed? Is it like an individual bank or to the FDIC, which I guess has regulatory authority over this?
Really what I would do is I would probably visit with the lending institution directly, and if the lending institution is unable to directly address the inquiry, then they will then defer to whomever their regulating agency is.
I think it's important to get an answer to that question too in order to address, for example, Councilman Herington's legitimate concerns, you know, how would our participation impact the monthly expenses of someone who holds a mortgage?
Right.
You can't really answer, you can't really address that concern unless you know what not participating might cause anyway.
Right, yeah. And I wish I could, but I cannot talk on behalf of the lending institutions.
I understand.
Right,
I mean, you had a feel for it.
Okay.
I have a question, and maybe Jason and Garrett could help with this. In the meeting we had today with some officials here in Washington, I thought Andy McGrail said that people will be required one way or another to get this, which is different than I believe what Monique's saying. Didn't he say that today? I can probably grab my notes. And he actually said that whether or not the city or the county adopts this mapping and floodplain insurance, does an ordinance, that people with federally backed mortgages will be required by the primary lender, the federally backed lender, or by the federal government, I guess, to get that insurance. And he also said, and you weren't there when he said,
I was not there, but I know Andy.
But he did refer to you maybe as the final say. I'm not sure how he said
that.
But he said it's the mortgage company that's going to determine the need for insurance.
Yes.
Irregardless of what the city council does.
Okay, so to expand on that, statute-wise, okay, we can't require flood insurance when flood insurance is not available. Okay,
right. Let's talk after September 29th.
So that doesn't matter. If you as a community are not participating in our program, okay, those loans that currently exist that are federally backed, that are now identified in a high-risk flood zone area, we can't mandate coverage because there's no coverage available if you're not participating. Okay, what to expand on what you just mentioned about what Andy had said. Now the lending institutions may have contractual authority to require coverage above and beyond statute. So even though the law might say, well, we can't force face it, you know, we can't force that requirement because it's not available, lenders may say, well, we have a contractual authority to require coverage, so now we are going to make you go and get it. And that's above and beyond our requirements. Okay? Now, that is on existing loans. Okay, with respect to new loans that are coming in, they can't get new loans because there is no flood insurance. They can get no new loans that are federally regulated or federally insured. Okay? So it's the existing ones versus the new ones. Okay? Because, and it's only for those structures identified in the special flood hazard area that we're really looking at. Does that make sense?
So in essence, all property south of Highway 22, with respect to Kauffman, if we chose to do nothing, could maintain status quo until a property transfer or a bank decides that they're going to institute and force insurance onto that owner.
Because they have contractual.
And the opportunity of getting a non-federally backed loan is
very difficult.
Very difficult.
Because often, even if they do not have a federal tie initially, most oftentimes than not, they're sold to the secondary market, and then you have a federal tie. Good questions? Any others? No. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Did you have any presentation?
No.
Okay. So
educated on.
I will just update, you know, we've talked a lot amongst the group and myself today. Probably the next step for us, if the council wants to continue to gather more information and allow the public to gather more information, is we'd set up a meeting with the banks, local insurers, and realtors, as all three of them are going to be infected, so that they gain a better knowledge of what this means to their business entity. Second.
And to their people.
Both banks, Hills and Freedom Security, were both present today at the meeting and had very good questions. And, you know, this would be another way that we can directly inform them, along with the insurers and the realtors involved, as they work together. The second part to that would be we set up a second public meeting similar to today, which was well attended. And we do that, and we, once it's in the paper, what these rates are, is when it's going to garner public questions. And at that point, we can bring Monique and her group in to specifically talk to property owners with respect to their property and what that's going to mean to them, and be able to read through these charts and know what that's going to do to them. So I think that would be, should the council deem that we want to keep proceeding, that would be what my recommendations would be going forward.
So how far in the future are we looking at this next meeting?
I think within 30 days, I think we have to have something set up for both of these, would be my inclination. And we talked about possibly doing a webinar for the first one, the banks, realtors, and insurers, and the second one obviously is going to have to be face-to-face. So.
Have those maps been published yet? I mean, they're back here, I've seen them back here, but has it been published to the general public yet?
No.
Okay, will that be done?
Yeah, we can do a PDF, Ron, if you can publish it to where it's going to look. You know.
Okay, I mean, now, you know, you say south of Highway 22 in the paper, and I've seen that and so forth. I mean, to actually physically see the
contour on it.
I have it on my website, part of a section that deals with Kelowna. Shucks.com.
So we can provide that to Ron. We had others request it today, so they could take a look at it a little bit closer. And, you know, something to make
I had a call today from Ed Raver. He wants to get together with Joe Rasso and Simco, and Rasso up there. If they're really, really concerned about this. I won't say what all I was told, but then it's not good. I told you. Not good at all. So, with it, we'll be in contact with you tomorrow. If you have another bit of contact.
I had a message stuff for me, but I had no chance for kind of.
I agree. I just want to say, answer to Ryan's question, and at least from my viewpoint, I do feel like we need to keep information about. Get as much education out there as we possibly can, get as much information as we possibly can, get word out to ultimately, prior to making the decision, those who have properties in the new newly mapped area, so they understand the impact it is going to have on them, and the decision that the council is ultimately going to make or not make, what impact that's going to have on them. I know you're working really hard. I appreciate what you've done so far to get people into these meetings. How many were there today?
I think we probably had between 30 and 40 that walked through.
Okay, so. That's great, because there's really just a few here this evening, and I think that's mainly representing banks and insurance companies. So that part is really important to get the truth of the matter out there to everybody. And that's all we can work to do, and then from there, we're going to have to make a decision, and I don't think either way it's an easy decision, which it really goes into be a really crucial decision that's going to have a very large financial impact on a lot of the population here, a lot of the businesses, property owners. Financially, it's probably the biggest decision we've made as a council, if we go ahead with it, how it'll affect people financially. And, so that's saying a lot. I think we just need to really keep moving forward, but get the word out there what's happening.
The financial impact, the biggest thing, is that maybe downtown project looks like peanuts. Figure it out. I'm in business now. What percentage of the affected areas downtown? I mean, what business is down there?
Yep, and it's hard to, you know, it's kind of a, it's a win-lose situation in a sense. I know FEMA wants to have all as many participate as possible, and it only becomes a win, which is still a lose if we have a monstrous flood here and, you know, all these properties get destroyed and most of our downtown. That's a big impact to kind of bear on our shoulders as a council if we don't go ahead with it and we have a flood. You know, that may have been a very stupid decision to make. But we could be heroes, too, if we didn't go ahead with it and there wasn't a flood for, at least in our generation. So, it's just a tough decision. That's all I'm saying. I'm sure you guys are aware of that. We've been to other communities, you know, that are affected by it. But our community, I think, is percentage-wise, has been affected almost more than any other examples that I've heard of so far. So it's a hard decision, you know. It's like the rules were changed, you know, and people don't like that. Not your fault. I know you're just the best person.
In the ninth inning. In the middle of the ninth inning, you're okay.
Well.
Okay. If we're gonna continue a question to end with it. We're going to step another meeting and then do the name to clear the table. Okay. Any other questions by the public? Okay. Item number two. Changes on beer permit for South Carryout Native Wine by KJ Table Store. Last step.
Meaning Iowa Wine? Is that what this is?
Yeah. Same permit we issued for another convenience store to sell. Okay. Kiosk style wine.
Okay.
I'll make the motion.
Motion by Herington, second by Lafaurie.
Can you look at the map?
All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Opposed say no. Motion carries. Anything else? Anybody?
I'll just let these guys know what I let you know earlier. Steve Yoder called me today and was very, very happy with the way the snow was removed from downtown. And very complimentary to the city crew. So pass that along.
Is that enough?